Hey Internet, I'm Chaz.
And I'm Dan. Welcome to Wine is Serious Business, episode 335. We're out in the Willamette Valley at one of the most exclusive tasting venues in the valley. Here with Taylor.
Taylor Davis.
Yeah, right. Taylor Davis of Davis Family Farms.
That's right.
In the barn.
Mm-hmm. Very fitting for tonight.
Yeah, yeah. It's very good. I was just talking about how impressed I was. We're in a barn. It doesn't smell like we're in a barn.
No, not here.
When did you redo this area?
So we bought this place in 2012 and have slowly been modifying things over time. And so this kind of came to fruition about 3 years ago. So
awesome.
We've been using it.
Sweet barn.
It's a beautiful spot and using it for wine events because wine's one of the things that anchored you in Oregon.
That's right.
We were just talking about like one of the things we love. Similar experience of discovery and really embracing it.
Yeah.
And one of the places that really grabbed his attention, really cemented that connection, was Maresh Red Barn.
That's right.
So he offered to open some old bottles that he had, tell some stories about there, mm-hmm. About his experiences there, and we're all over it. We're so excited to share
right,
that.
Yeah,
this is
going to be an amazing experience.
So let's start with that. I'll get the wine in the glass, so a little bit of rinses, and maybe you could tell the story of like your first day out there, your first memory of Maresh Red Barn.
Well, so my wife and I came out here to Oregon for our honeymoon, and on our way out to the coast to stay a few days out there, we hit the Willamette Wine Valley and just really, really fell in love with the place, the people, the wine, the whole experience. And one of my favorites, we actually didn't go, I don't think we went on our exact year of our honeymoon, but I started coming back out here about every 3 to 4 months. We actually lived in Kansas at the time. And I would just do a tour of the area, and here, I'll get rid of that.
Yeah, okay, yeah. Put that down.
Yeah, you gotta get down. There we
go. No problem. And whenever, if you drink any, or if you read any books or read any history about the Oregon or about Willamette Valley, one of the most historical areas is basically 9th Street coming out of Dundee, and that's where you run into Maresh Red Barn. Maresh Red Barn is the fifth oldest vineyard in all of Oregon, as from a Pinot Noir perspective, as the oldest. Sauvignon Blanc planted in all of Oregon.
Wow.
And
I did not know that.
So, yeah. Yeah.
Cool.
It's a great story. You know, there's a great book if you really are interested in Oregon wine called The Boys Up North, and it really tells the history of David Lett, of Dickie Rath, Jim Maresh and family, the Ponzies, Adelsheims, all coming up here and really establishing a whole new wine region that was really unknown to the whole world. And from that, I had read that book. And really started just, you know, you walk in the Red Barn, you just feel very comfortable. It's a small space. It looks at all the beautiful Knutson vineyards and Velavita vineyards. And, you know, the gym floor comes from the old Tigard High School. I'm sorry, the floor in the barn comes from the old Tigard High School.
Wow.
And it just feels like a nice, comfortable place. The tasting room manager there was a guy, permanent, always wore overalls, a guy named Sam, excuse me. And was the tasting room manager there for years and years and years, and really made my wife and I feel very, very comfortable.
Nice.
Which I think was something all of us found striking when we started tasting wine in Oregon, that there were a lot of, you know, there's different angles, right? When you start making tasting room, you start thinking about hospitality, there's different angles. One is to go like super over the top luxury, right? Opulence.
Yeah.
And really wow people that way. And there's another angle where it doesn't matter who you are, right? It's super comfortable. You know, we got a personal connection. Maybe the settings are simple, but anybody can walk in, feel welcome, have a good time, and get to experience some great wines.
Absolutely. You know, when I take my family and friends or visitors out, you know, I kind of ask them like, what's important? I mean, do you want to eat in a great? Do you want to taste wine in a big place? You know, like what's really important to you? And I know it sounds silly to say the wine, but in the wine is absolutely critical. But it's also it's the venue. Is it the place? Is it the history? Is it, you know, what you're looking at, the experience? So I really take all those factors account of when I take people out for for tours, because you can have a completely independent experience of the wine. Of course, the wine is important, but
and once you get to know the people, you know, who's
and then it just
spells
love. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, absolutely. It's great. What's in the glass? What do we have here?
So this is actually so one thing I want to tell you a little about these wines is that a lot of these were gifted to me personally by Jim, and so especially some of these older whites. So when I work in a pretty high pressure IT job, and one of my things I used to do on Fridays is I would go out and sit on the back deck at Domaine Druin, DuPont, or Maresh Red Barn. And whenever I sat there, Jim Maresh, and I hope we're going to put some pictures up here, would come out and I would just sit here talking with him. And, you know, I just went to his 90th birthday party last year. He moved out here in 1959, bought 24 acres, and over time built that up to 140 acres, 9th Street, Warden Hill Road, just right outside of Dundee. And he would get off his tractor, come up, and we would sit and have a glass of wine. And grandparents are super, really special to me. You know, I lost all my grandparents, and to be able to sit down with Jim and hear stories was just a really awesome experience. And so,
hey, cheers to grandfather. We both lost grandfathers in the last couple of years.
Oh, there we go.
So, cheers to Jim. They're the best. Grandpa cheers.
So, so a lot of these, I'd be sitting around his fireplace up at his house, and he'd be, hey, you know, I made this white wine way back in the day, I'm not sure how it tastes, but you know, would you appreciate this? So honestly, these have been sitting in my cellar for, you know, we've been out here, coming out here 14, 15 years, and I'm not even sure when I got this. So one thing I thought was interesting when I asked Jim, I go, you know, I was, you know, super excited to be in Oregon and kind of naive about it, and I'd be like, Jim, what kind of wines do you age, and what kind of wines do you put away? And he's like, at the time, he'd be, you know, whatever, 78 or 86, whatever. He's like, you know, Taylor, I don't age wines at my age. I drink wines, right? And so anyway, so he would give me some of these older wines to taste. So the first one here is a 09 Sauvignon Blanc, like I said, from the oldest Sauvignon Blanc vineyard in all of Oregon.
I noticed from looking at these, a lot of them have different, like produced and bottled by.
Yeah, right? So one thing, so if you look at, and I don't want to misrepresent any facts here, but if you look at a lot of really famous, let's say highly rated wines in Oregon, and please, you know, you'll see a lot of those come from Maresh Red Barn vineyards, or you'll see former vineyards that were Maresh that are now owned by other vineyards, such as like Arcus or things like that, owned by Archery Summit. That a lot of those vineyards, Ed Fee, like a lot of those come from Maresh. A lot of Kelly Fox's wines that won so many awards, you know, came from Maresh Red Barn. So historically, Maresh Red Barn has always been a producer. Just because you have a vineyard doesn't mean you have a winery. Because you have a winery doesn't mean you have a vineyard.
Yeah.
And Maresh, Jim Maresh was a farmer. And what he would do is say, hey, here's 50 tons of grapes. You pay me this much money and you give me back a couple of cases of wine that I sell in my tasting room because I love the experience of showcasing wine and selling wine.
Cool.
This was after his son-in-law died and who was a really up and coming winemaker here. He died in, I think it was in 1990, which is Jimmy. If you've ever heard of Jimmy Maresh, Artery Maresh Wines, that is was his dad. His stepdad is Steve, and is currently married to his mom Martha, who is Jim, Grandpa Jim's. I have to do a whole whiteboard.
Yeah, yeah. I'm sorry.
Anyways, I'm sorry to get sidetracked.
No pressure.
We're just talking about history of the vineyard.
Yeah, history of vineyard.
Let's talk about the Sauvignon Blanc. On the nose, I'm getting a little bit of tropical fruit.
Yeah.
But
would you guess this is nearly like it's 8 years old?
Mm-hmm.
Never guess.
Yeah. I'm really actually surprised by how youthful it is at this point, right? 2009, kind of a warmer vintage. You would expect a little bit of rollover, like maybe a bit of oxidation, and you don't. I don't see any of that, personally.
No,
and maybe that's the grape. Maybe it's the vines being very old vines. You know?
It's a lot of acidity. It's still. I mean, it's, you know, not to go through the whole, but you know, clear, yellow straw type color. Yellow color.
It shows maybe a little hint of the age on the color, right?
Yeah.
But, a little bit on the nose. I can see it just starting to age, but on the palate, man, it's in a great spot. I really love just the freshness of the acidity. You get a little bit of those richer fruits in there, but they're so well balanced. I honestly would guess that this is like 2 years old or something. Yeah. I can't believe how well it's holding up.
Yeah. It's actually changed a little bit even since we opened it, I think.
Sure.
I'm really excited to move next to Chardonnay. So I kind of remember my train of thought. So what he would do, like I said, Jim would take a few, would take payment for his grapes, but then would also have some of these setbacks. The point of this is that this particular Sauvignon Blanc this particular wine was produced by Jay Christopher. So there was a lot of different producers that you would see that over time you saw Rex Hill made kind of their flagship. Rex Hill was the producer of their flagship wine for several years. One of the wines over here was actually, it's Archery Summit actually made one of their Pinot Noirs here. So,
and Jay Christopher kind of made a name for himself with the Sauvignon Blanc from there, so that's pretty good.
Yeah, he had a blend. It was a Jay Christopher blend of Sauvignon Blanc and some Riesling or something like that for a while. Anyway, so that's what I was trying to ask your question, is that that's the reason why a lot of these bottles, and these bottles, one thing also is that these bottles are really rare, the basis that you could never buy these in a grocery store. None of these were ever distributed anywhere. So these wines, like literally we're drinking the history, like the true history of Oregon wine, that these were only accessible in the vineyard.
And these would have been the original Sauvignon Blanc vines that he planted,
So a lot of these, if you go out there,
sort of makes sense,
when you look at the age of some of these and you go out and look at the vineyard, these are huge, gnarly wines. And I've already talked to Jimmy and some of these guys, like, I want to put, I want to take one of those wines and mount them.
Put them
in the wall if one ever gets knocked over by the tractor or something like that.
Yeah, and man,
that's why you see the.
If you're watching this and haven't seen pictures, even just Google for them.
We'll work with Jess to get some pictures.
Absolutely. Yeah, good.
So, sorry for lost the train of thought.
No, that's good stuff.
My friend John, or the friend of the show, John Moser, when he came out to Oregon, he just came here briefly for literally 4 or 5 hours. Took him, his brother, and his father through the Willamette Valley, but we stopped at DuPont, and then he wanted to go to the Red Barn really bad. And I remember he was walking around, picking up the dirt, just walking around.
One thing,
loves Oregon wine, right?
So I just thought of this. That this is a really big deal. So if you're on the back, if you want to go to Maresh Red Barn, taste their newer generation of wines, and you want to see something truly unique, you need to go out there. Immediately, what happened is if you're at Maresh Red Barn, you're sitting on the back deck, you're looking at the original Vadensville vines planted, 46 years ago.
Wow.
When you look over, there's a basalt mine over to the west, and something broke up on the hill, and there's a huge waterfall. Now, you can hear it from Maresh Red Barn. All the rain of everything we've had this winter.
Oh, yeah.
You're sitting there, and there's this mini Multnomah Falls now coming down that basalt thing. Going right down. So anyway, sorry. So I just remember
damaging any of the vineyard or anything.
No. It's way over there. Now, ironically, it'd be really cool if there was a road over there. Because if there was a road over there, we wouldn't have to go down 99. You could go from Maresh Red Barn right over to Domaine Druin, right down into DuPont, all of that. So.
Anyone who commutes through Dundee's understands the struggle. It's brutal. Mm-hmm. All right, so let's move on to the next one. Mm-hmm. This is the 2007 Chardonnay.
Tasting this, I'm amazed more people haven't planted Sauvignon Blanc.
Yeah.
Right. There's only a few, right? I know Patricia Green's had some pretty good luck with it. Who else? Boy. Ooh. All right.
It's still a little...
Yeah, a little funky.
Yeah.
This is where our organologist coming up short. I know there's a guy in southern Willamette Valley that's got some Sauv Blanc, but I can't bring it to mind.
Yeah.
It's all right. Yeah, it's all good. Forget it. Let's talk Chardonnay.
Yeah.
Big love for Chardonnay always. Mm-hmm. Did you ever have big talks about the white wines there, or was it mostly Pinot Noir focus when you'd hang out on the deck?
With Jim? Jim had just a lot of stories in general. I don't think he really talked about specific varietals. He would always say, I'm this old because I drink, Pinot Noir every day. So I didn't really hear him.
Line.
I think he always really talked about his red wines. And if you ever saw him at the barn, one thing, I don't know if you guys, if you've been going to Maresh Red Barn for a while, they always poured out these little teeny glasses. They always had these small glasses.
Yep.
And actually, I have the glass. I should have brought it up here. It's in the house.
Yeah.
But they had a glass just for me in there. And it was original Oregon Pinot Noir glass. So I went in there, and they actually went and got it engraved. It says Maresh Red Barn on it. I can't believe I don't have it out here. But anyways, they've changed all the glasses out there.
You should be drinking out of it right now.
Yeah, yeah. I cleaned it off when I brought them all out here. I thought this was it. So, anyway, so he never really talked about those things. A lot of things... he did bring up one thing, a little nice story. I remember we were sitting on the back deck there, and beautiful day, and there was a group of people that, were really, I'd say a little too intellectual of what they were talking about at the time, but they were really waxing and waning about this block of Vadensville, of how, the vineyard or the vineyard space is this wide, that's because it's a north slope and it needed more air. They must have had problems with humidity or with rot, so they've spaced the vines to get air, and then they had a certain height to make sure the sun came down and get everything. And I'm wondering what the vineyard manager, you know, was really thinking when he placed these vines that far apart. And we're sitting there, and Jim's just chuckling away. And he gets up and he's like, "Well, I'll tell you the reason why, that my 1946 Ford tractor was 6 feet wide, and that's the reason why those lanes are basically that wide." So anyways, there's a lot of different things we talked about, but
was the 46 tractor still in service too? Did you
no, it? It was Ford tractor. So okay, that's another side subject here.
Okay.
Tractors
after Chardonnay.
Yeah. Tractors. They, right.
They just definitely shows through on the nose.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. This is definitely, it's got
a little
banana,
toasted marshmallow.
Yeah. On here. I wouldn't have picked this up as a Chardonnay.
No way. I don't know what I'd
really.
It's just a different. I've never had this flavor with a Chardonnay.
So and I would have guessed some white Rhone variety, something a little richer. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
There we go. Yeah, that's actually a good call.
And it's got kind of funky.
It's not
flavor.
That oily, but it's a smooth mallow, maybe, or something.
The malolactic fruit. Yeah.
Yeah. Really.
Is it that sort of like buttery sort of flavor?
Yeah, it's not an oak buttery, but it's like the texture.
Yeah.
It's not the flavor, but it's the texture.
I totally would, would have said Marsan. Like, yeah.
You're right about the whole Rhone white thing.
Yeah,
you
this
could
is a
totally call
maple.
This.
Huh.
Yeah. You could totally say this was like a Marsan Roussan blend or something. Mm-hmm. Right? It's kind of crazy. Mm. It's like a little bit spicy. It's got a little bit of fresh fruit. But there's like all this, like, there's almost like weight and like viscosity to it a bit. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Interesting.
It's interesting. I mean, for me, I don't know what you'd pair with this, but
blue cheese.
Yeah, I do.
But
yeah. It's almost like a less. Honey, it is almost like a less rich. Yeah, you're right. Oh.
So
So Jim, like I said, Jim rides his tractors still every day. At 90 years old, and it's funny.
It's a good life, man.
He's got two John Deeres. He's very proud of his John Deeres. When I bought a New Holland, he really sat me down and talked to me.
Farms where you grew up? What was the big tractor there?
We had Fords and John Deeres.
Yeah. Okay.
Well, my grandpa actually had every kind of tractor on the planet. Sorry, we are on the farm, so we actually have coyotes howling here in the distance. So
nice.
So it's funny. You know, Jim has an older. I think it's a 50/50 John Deere. Really classic, long term. Been around forever, and he calls that Little Balls. And he's got a much bigger, it's a 75 or 100 horse tractor. He calls that Big Balls. And so he'd sit there like, "Well, I got to get Big Balls ready to go today, or I got Little Balls. I got to get that one ready to go, move the implement over to here." But he's still a super active, sweet guy that, if you get a chance to get down there to meet him, you really should.
And I think all the guys that generation.
I haven't ran into him at this point. Yeah, going to the Red Barn as many times as I have at this point, it's like. Does he ever hang out at the Red Barn still, or is he?
No, he does. He'll come down every afternoon. He lives so. If you're at the Red Barn and you're looking straight, I think that'd be east. That house surrounded by the cherries, that is his house, and he lives there.
Just go up on the knock on the door. Drink enough wine. Like,
well, Jimmy or his lovely wife Alex really run the tasting room now, and so if you want to talk with them, they can call him and just see how he's what he's up to. He's still a very busy guy. Just to check in. Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Yeah. And I've had a good time. I've had a good time there. I said the last time you were there, Jimmy, was right. It was an Arterberry Marsh lineup, right? Like that.
Oh,
was,
yeah.
Yeah. It was. And great stop. If you haven't been out there yet, definitely.
Still on the ground. Dan. sorry. Yeah, there it is. First F-bomb of the show.
Yeah.
All right. A little rinse, guys.
Yeah. Splash of wine.
No, that's good.
One of these days, we're going to soak this mic in wine.
All right, so we're stepping way back in Oregon history here, 1999.
Before any of us? No, before Taylor
this
and I.
This is.
I was. In,
and it opened up, right?
Yeah.
From when you popped the cork.
Yeah.
We were just talking about this. I've had some crazy experiences lately where you open an older bottle of Oregon wine. We're talking getting around 20 years old, and your first expression, you're like, "Oh, we missed the boat. Oh, it's dead. Ah, oh, I feel so bad." Yeah. You come back to it after 20 minutes.
Yeah, this is.
And the magic is still there.
Blowing up.
Yeah.
We got to get, Wow. This has got that brick and this. I mean, this.
Yeah, the age is showing, brick, leather, right?
Yeah.
This is from Bill Pond.
Dirt. So this was produced cool. Boy, and they were doing amazing stuff at this point in time. I think 98 and 99 are definitely some of my favorite older Oregon vintages. I had great experiences with a few of those.
I've had really good luck with, too, like 94, 95. I know 97 was panned universally, but I had a Roosevelt 97 from Elk Cove that just blew me away. Mm-hmm. But like a lot of people say, it seems to be, I mean, there's a lot of people understand that Oregon Pinot does age pretty well, right? But there's a lot of people that don't think it ages very well.
Yeah, a lot of people here know that it ages well.
Yeah. Right.
Well, a lot of us do. I think even more Oregonians need to know. Candidly, I think.
Absolutely.
The more keen to know what the capability of these wines from aging
is. Yeah, and I've been lucky and been privileged to try some, you know, stuff from the 70s and the 80s. Mm-hmm. And I mean, even at like 20, 30 years, they age really well, as long as the producer was good and the vineyard was,
absolutely. Awesome.
So,
And we were talking about how it really, really gets our goat. When we read press articles, we're like, this will age beautiful for 3 to 7 years or whatever. And I'm like, that's just dumb. Or you don't know. If you believe that Oregon wine doesn't age, get into stuff like this.
Yeah, if you want to piss off somebody talking about how this year sucked or that, tell that to Jesse Lang. Like Jesse Lang is about, it's about the farming. It's about, you should never have a bad year. You're going to have different years, but through the farming and through your winemaking, you should always have, that's the part of making unique and vintage, terroir driven type wine. So this is really we've opened this. This has been open about an hour probably, or maybe a little less. I mean, has it been? Anything else really done to it? We haven't.
It's completely come alive.
But it's it's
on
really
palate. Like it's just. You've got like some sort of youthful cherries and like a little bit of like maybe raspberry, but then like it goes into the less like whole like dried cranberry, dried cherry, maybe even a hint of like prettiness, but it's like just a hint of it.
Yeah, it's bit acidity,
a little bit peppery, a little bit leathery,
a little like menthol just, herbal overtone on everything.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
This would be a fun wine to pour.
This is freaking good.
For a Francophile or someone that just is like only French wine or whatever. I think this would be something that would be confusing.
Absolutely.
This would be confusing. This would definitely blow somebody's.
Go ahead. No, I mean it's pleasing like academically and hedonistically, right? Like there's just good stuff going on across the board.
Yeah.
And it gives you something to think about.
When you get an old wine, it's always tough, right? Like sometimes you've got the wines where it's like, I just want to share this with people who will understand it educationally because I don't want to drink this on my own. This is not that wine. Yeah. I would drink this alone in a corner. Like this is good.
Yeah.
This is good stuff.
This is delicious. Like this would be great with food. This is also sit by the fireplace, man. We'll be by the fireplace over here later.
Momentarily. Yeah.
Yeah. Sitting and drinking.
Did you did you get to drink older wines at the tasting room ever? Did they ever any of that from behind?
No.
The,
okay, honestly, we would be sitting drinking the current whatever offerings.
Yeah.
And Sam or him, would go in the back of the barn there. They had their kind of storage room in the back, and he'd be like, hey, take one of these home. I do have a funny story, Jimmy and Alex, if you guys are watching this. I did go out there. They had a white, Martha's White, I think, and Alex was being so nice. She goes, hey, there's 6 bottles of this left. We've had some issues with some effervescence in it. Would you like to have it? And I'm like, it was a hot summer day. I'm like, who wouldn't want to have a couple of these? So I had my wife's car, and I put in my wife's car. I drove home and pulled up in my house, and all of a sudden it was pop, 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 and it was like I was in a rain of white wine in the back of my. So, anyways, that was a fun story.
That car smells wonderful for years.
Yeah. So, anyways, but no, so I, we never really did. We really drink. I would just buy a bottle and sit on the back. And talk with him. One great way to talk to get in Jim's heart too is he's from Wisconsin. Every year he gets a case of wine. He gets on a train and he takes the train all the way to Wisconsin drinking wine in his private car. He loves walleye fish. To him, walleye fish is like the most exotic fancy. So
it's great. It's hard to find out here.
Not to. I'm not trying to advertise you, but Northwest, fish and fresh seafood in Newburgh is an absolutely fantastic fishmonger. And they stock it. They literally stock the fish there just really for Jim.
I had no idea. I'm going to buy some next time I go.
Yeah,
there.
Yeah, that's right.
I grew up in Minnesota, so yeah. I mean, it's like similar. Yeah. Like
they loves walleye. So, yeah. And he does a lot of sports references. All my friends, if you're watching this, I absolutely have no concept of sports references. So if you know anything about Wisconsin college, whatever. Walleye and fine wine.
Walleye and Badgers.
Yeah, if you talk trackers too, you can.
Walleyeandbadgers.com. Yeah. That'd be a good website.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. Anyways.
All right. So the 1999 Pinot Noir disappeared. So we're going to move on to the 2011 and do a little rinse. Yeah. And the 2011 was produced and bottled by Powell Hill Winery.
Yeah. So Jimmy and there. It's one of our random bovines there. Jimmy and his mom, Martha, who is Grandpa Jim's daughter, and her husband, Steve, have built a small winery.
Powell Hill. They sell it out of the Red Barn, don't they?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's, I've had it before. Yeah,
that's the small winery they got licensed, and that's where Jim is now making Arterbury Marsh, all the other really amazing Chardonnays and Pinot Noir that he has. So he has an estate. He's also sourcing fruit from Weber. Mm-hmm. Which we could do a modern batch. We can get Jimmy up here, this is from kind of when they started originally getting that license and getting back into actually producing wine versus being the farming aspect of it, or being the source of the producer of the fruit.
If you could turn back time, those first couple years you were out visiting, put yourself on the back deck. Yeah. What bottle do you order? What bottle do you order to pour into your glass? You only get one glass. The time machine doesn't last very long.
I would say Loewy's Block. All right. That was the wine that was really their flagship, that he would actually take some of that and donate it to the, I think it was a local library, but Loewy was Jim's wife. Died, probably 20 years ago or so. That probably was just it was an amazing wine. If I had to go second, it would be down to the Archery Summit they had, and then Rex Hill actually produced it. Well, Rex Hill actually made the. Lynn Pinner-Ash made that. So Lynn Pinner-Ash, when she was at Rex Hill, actually made that particular wine.
So a bit of that interconnected.
Oh, there's Oregon, so many. Yeah, Oregon guys, history. Like this is, we have a whiteboard here behind the camera here. Yeah. To draw the interconnections of
if you'll draw, I'll shoot a photograph of it.
Yeah, Kelly Fox and Lynn Pinner-Ash and Rex Hill and Archery Summit and Arc. You know, like it really goes on from what was really. I mean, going back to what a dream of a guy that drove an old beat up BMW.
Go ahead.
Okay.
No.
sorry.
That'll ruin the audio anyway. So we gotta
I choke people up.
Yeah, I just got some down the wrong path.
We got some tears. Okay, let's talk about our grandfather.
Yeah, yeah. Well, no. It goes back to it really goes back to Dickie driving up in an old beat up BMW, pulling into Jim's driveway, saying, "Hey, you should rip all these filbert orchards out, and you should plant vineyards." And Jim going, "Who the hell is this?" And then really, you know, saying, "Hey, let's do that." Building that out. You know, of course, there were the previous guys, David Lett and. You know, folks like that had been around, but you know, Dick Erath was really one of the guys that really put Oregon on the map, just from a marketing, you know, getting that name out. And Jim Marsh was one of the original producers of that fruit. I mean, so you're really talking about the one of the most fundamental guys of building the Oregon wine industry. So,
yeah, and it's great to hear it's great to hear these stories, keep them alive. A lot of this stuff is news to me. I've never heard of that the Loewy wine. Mm-hmm. That's I hadn't heard of it. So
I don't have any left.
That's all right.
I'm sure Jim does. Maybe we'll do a rev two of this and
find
we'll see
a bottle
we can,
of that. Yeah.
We'll see. Yeah, little treasures from the past, but still good to hear those stories, get them recorded. That's part of what keeps us doing this show.
Yeah.
Man, this is drinking so well now.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Talking about 2011. Yeah. I got so caught up in my coughing that I lost touch with reality there for a second.
Great
so,
raspberries, a little bit of hibiscus flavor. I guess I'm mostly talking about the palate. But just light, fresh, but with a good intensity still. Man, I've had three quality producer 2011s in the last couple of days, and they've all been smoking.
Yeah, well, that's what I was talking about. having a year panned by the press or panned by the media or panned by some wine writer, this is one of the years, right? Where it was like 2011 sucks. Well, completely debunked.
Right. I'm not sure who coined it, like who I heard this quote from, but it was like no vintage is better or worse. It's just different.
Yeah, well, right? That's what's
just. And I think that it takes a while to like wrap your head around as a wine drinker, and like once you figure it out, especially once you like fall in love with a region.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. Right. Then you really start to respect like vintages like 2011, and 2011 provides something that no other vintage provides, at least in the last 10 years.
It was hard on release.
Right.
It was
brutal.
And there are
still 2011s that are undrinkable. I've opened a couple recently where I'm just like, ugh.
But I've had some great ones. Do yourself a favor. Agreed. Crack into one if you get a chance.
Like 80% of them have been good that I've had recently.
Yeah.
So, yeah. All right. So I was going to ask, like, as someone like you've consumed a lot of Oregon wine, like a favorite vintage for reds.
You know, I don't. I love to. You know, my experience, honestly, my experiences are tied with the people and the wines and everything.
Yeah.
And my objectivity is so screwed up in a good way. Does that make sense?
Absolutely. No, I feel like we're in a similar spot.
So I'd love to say, like, I mean, I would say, like, for me, maybe, like, I just remember the 012s, like, kind of they're just ready to drink, like, right in your face, I guess, maybe. You know, but for me, like, just my time, my history, my experiences, you know, I had the privilege to work crush at Lang. I worked at a vineyard, Yamhill Vineyards, Linda and Ralph, Sue and Ralph Stein, who supplied some of the original Pinot Gris, you know, to Lang and some of the original, anyways, I've had so many experiences that it just, lovely that I think of more the times I was drinking wine, the times I was working the vineyards versus like,
sure.
And I'm not saying that's the right way. Just
I don't know. Well, we're kind of with you on that too. Okay. Where
memories play into it.
Yeah, and you can make a lot of criticisms about how we're not as objective as maybe you should be when you talk about descriptions and writing the wines. But but you can't separate the connections you make with people from the experience of drinking with the wine. And I think you can only really be objective if like we went down 3 times a year to taste a Napa and never hung out with anybody. Right, but you can't can't be objective when you spend time so on the deck getting to know the people.
Yeah, I'm so surrounded with the love. You know, people always say like,
"Why did 2011?
How did you? Why did you move to Oregon? Like, what job or you know, how did you know what was the career move that you?" And I was like, I was very well compensated living where we were. Very, you know. And literally, it was the love of the people and the food. And I'm always like, "What made you move here?" It's like food and booze. That is literally the reason why I moved out here.
Yeah.
And
it's part of the reason.
And
literally,
the people. It was the Langs. It was Jim Marsh and Sam and all those people.
Yeah, and all these people could have told you to get lost, right? Like you.
Oh, I got a lot of people telling me to get lost.
But you weren't coming up here to buy 10 cases, right, of wine or whatever at the time.
No, I mean, at the time when we were up here, you know, we were talking about, hey, $50
right.
day, that was a big day. You know, you'd go
in,
and it was those people that really appreciated an enthusiastic, curious person
Yeah, and not only like, oh, hi, it's nice to see you. Like, let's talk. Let's bring you into the experience. And
it still seems to be that way. Like, a lot of Oregon producers are just excited that you're excited.
Yeah.
Like, you're here.
This industry is, I think maybe it's getting, I don't want to say, but I think it's maybe maturing a little bit, but it's around the business side. But but overall, there's still no place as accepting and willing to get you into experiences where you can learn and treasure this. So
I feel like no matter who you are now, you can find some place in Oregon where you can hang out and really connect with the people making the wine across the wide range of personalities and lifestyles. There's a spot for you.
That's why you guys are here with
right
us.
Yeah.
On the Western Seaboard, like on the West Coast, there is no easier place to get into than the Willamette Valley.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Like I mean, maybe Umpqua Valley to a small extent. Like they're still pumped that new people are coming in, but like Willamette Valley is like just so laid back and so fun to explore.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Yeah. All right.
We're digressing. Anyway, but
thank you guys. So this was fun. I've got some other kinds of lineups like this, and it'd be a lot of fun to do this again.
We